This is Sparta!
Shalom, Mishkapa. I am Kahan Tazadaq, one who sent, a prophet, a seer, and a grieved man. And this is a divine message that I was actually sent to give to you in a particular dispensation of time. The name of the Father, the name of the Son. This is right knowledge revealed to those that can receive it. It is unfortunate that most of you are not able to receive this message. But for the selected few, the elect that can receive it, understand this right knowledge. First, we're going to deal with the woman and what you refer to as the original sin. If you can contain your emotions or just overcome your aphasia and cognitive dissonance, you will receive this right knowledge, which is truth, which is life-altering. This is for the non-emotional, those that's operating on a different realm. I'm here to take you into that other dimension of truth. I'm Kahan Tazadaq, and this is Right Knowledge for Real. The seer, the reformer, the one to prepare the way for Yahusha, the one that is to come. So with that being said, let's deal with the set apart name, Yahuwah or Yahawah. Now I'm going to explain why both Yahuwah and Yahawah is correct with the name. But the name is not Jehovah. I'm going to go into how that became a mistranslation, because the priests of the times, the Kahans, or as you say in the modern Hebrew, Kohans of the time, did not want the nations pronouncing the sacred name. So the name was disguised. And so the modern world today is using the mispronunciations, and therefore you're not fulfilling the scriptures, because the scriptures state, "He that calls upon my name shall be saved." But if you're not using the correct name, what does that say? You can't go against the world and create your own paradigm. But that's exactly what you've done. The word Yahweh is a little closer to the truth, but it's not the name. First and foremost, I want to give triple honors to the Elder Taha for teaching all of the men of Yahuwah out there real right knowledge, real truth. And despite all of the enemies that's raised up against that man of Adonai, man of Yahuwah, Yahawashai, Yahuwah, Yahusha, keep teaching that truth, Elder. Keep teaching that truth. Shout out to GMS. They don't like GMS because GMS teaches the truth. And the one that brought me into the nation of Yasha Allah was literally taught under the Elder Taha, the good brother Ramallah. So enough to that, but triple honors to the Elder Taha. So now let's deal with the set apart nation. Let's go. If you want to know the name of the Heavenly Father, then the Spirit has led you to the right place. It is not God. It is not Lord. Yahuwah, Yahuwah is the name of the Almighty, the creator of Shemayim and Eretz, the heaven and earths. His name is pronounced Yahuwah or Yahuwah. I'm going to explain why it's suffice to say either Yahuwah or Yahuwah. His name is spelled with four Hebrew letters written from right to left. Yud, Hey, Oh. Now, since they brought the W in, some of you say Wah, Hey. And this is often referred to as the Tetragrammaton, meaning four letters. And it's commonly written in English letters of YH, WH. Now, let me explain why, when you're doing a transliteration, that Yahuwah and Yahuwah is both good. Because remember, the W in the English transliteration is YHWH, right? So the W comes from what? The U sound. So the U, that sound would have been a ooh, right? Because a W was what? Two V's that they put together. And we know that the V comes from what? So this is why they put the W there. And so when a lot of Israelites read that, instead of pronouncing it with the U, they pronounce it with the wah, wah, the W sound, right? But remember, before the W came into existence, it was just a U. Now you can look at the origin of the W. It was not in the original alphabet, right? So when we deal with English transliterations, it throw us off. And the V, well, that came from Latin. And the V originally had the U sound. I digress. The Tetragrammaton, the Hebrew word of the four letters, Yud, He, He, or Yud, He, Wah, He. The Hebrew of the four letters consisting a divine proper name, which Jews, out of reverence or for fear of desecration, ceased to pronounce about 3 century BC, and for which they substitute Adonai or Elohim. So this is what I try to explain to JD and many people that refer to themselves as Jewish, right? Since a lot of them don't study history and they're not one, but I'm one who's sent to help all, right? And I deal with linguistics. So I try and explain to them that in the modern Ibrit, when you're saying Adonai, that's a substitution for the true name. They don't want to say the name. They believe the name is too sacred to pronounce, or they say Elohim, which really is what they refer to as modern Ibrit. It's not the original Hebrew, but because that Elohim would be Elohim, meaning the powers. Now my good brother Julio said, well, how do you know Elohim? It's the powers. The short answer is because I'm one who knows I'm a seer. I'm a prophet of the Most High. Bahashem, I'm a seer. But the long answer is because if you look it up in the Ibrit, that's what it means, the powers. And when you look in many translations, it may be listed as rulers, but it comes from the shorter word Elo, or in the Paleo, Allah. In Arabic, Allah. It is not a name. And being variously transliterated without indicating of these vocalizations by YHWH, YHVH, JHVH, JHWH, or IHVH, and with vowels USU by Jehovah, Yahweh, Jehovah, Yahweh, Yahweh, and so on and so forth. So the four letters of the Almighty's name was written in the original Ibrit text of the scriptures over 6,800 times. But when the text was translated into English, the name Yahuwah or Yahuwah was replaced with the word Lord and God, written in small caps. Now you can verify this in the right in the preference of your Bibles. All you have to do is read. In any of your Bibles, you can verify what Kahan Tazadaq is saying. But you don't like to read. You like just to jump to the meat when you should be sipping on the milk, right? Because you're really babies in this, right? You just follow with your rabbi, with your priest, or with your Baptist preacher or your minister taught you, but you can verify this in the preference to the Bible. The part in the front of your Bible that nobody ever reads, it's right there. See, most Bibles have a page, have a passage in the preference that refers to the name of the Father. It usually refers to as the covenant or the scarce divine name. And in that particular passage, the publisher will tell you how the name of the Almighty Yahweh or Yahuwah, the YHWH, was replaced with Lord or God. Giggle, giggle. Usually the reason that they give for the substitution is tradition. It's the way it is, and it's been done that way for years. The new publishers simply follows the crowd. But I, one who have been sent, Kahan Tazadaq, a seer, a prophet, a messenger of the Most High, have come to give you this right knowledge. Now here's an example of what I'm talking about. Let's look at the preference to the New English Bible. See what I have highlighted here? It says, this personal proper name written with the consonant YHWH was considered to be too scarce to be uttered, so the vowels for the words my Lord or God were added to the consonant YHWH, and the readers was warned by those vowels that he must substitute other consonants. This change having to be made so frequently, rabbis did not consider it necessary to put the consonants of the new readings in the margins. In course of time, the true pronunciations of the divine name, probably Yahweh, which is also wrong also, passed into oblivion, and YHWH was read with the intruded vowels, the vowels of an entirely different word, namely my Lord or God. In late medieval times, this mispronunciation became current as Jehovah, and it was taken over to Jehovah by the reformers in the Protestant Bibles. The present translation have retained this incorrect but customary form in the text of passage where the name is explained with a note on the pronunciation, Shemot 3 and 15, aka the Greek word Exodus, and in the four names of which a form a consonant element. Elsewhere, they follow ancient translations and substitute in Lord or God printed as here in capital letters for the Hebrew name. Y'all see that, right? So we go to the preference of the New Living Translation. All appearances of El Elohim, Eloah, Eliah have been translated God, except where the context demands the translation God's, lowercase g. We have rendered the tetragrammaton, the YHWH, consistently as Lord, utilizing a form with small capitals that is common amongst English translation. This would distinguish it from the name Adonai, which we render Lord. When Adonai and the YHWH appears in conjunction, we have rendered it Sovereign Lord. This also distinguishes Adonai, YHWH, from cases where YHWH appears with Elohim, which is rendered Lord God. When YH, the short form of the YHWH, and YHWH appears together, we rendered it Lord God. The Hebrew word Adon is to render Lord or Master or sometimes Sir. So we go over to the preference to the King James Version, the one that we all know and love, right? The format. The format of the New King James Version is designed to enhance the vividness and devotional quality of the Holy Spirit. subject headings assist the readers to identify topics and translations in biblical context. Words or phrases in italics indicate expressions in the original language which require clarification by additional English words, and also done through the history of the King James Bible. Verses, numbers, and bold type indicated the beginning of a paragraph. Oblique type in the New Trent in the New Testament indicate a quotation from the Old Testament. So let's go down to where it says, covenant name of God was usually translated from Hebrew as Lord or God, using capital letters as shown in the King James Old Testament. The tradition is maintained. In the present editions, the name is so capitalized whenever the covenant name is quoted in the New Testament from the passage. Now you go over to the New International Version. In regards to the divine name, YHWH, commonly referred to as the Tetragrammaton, the translator adopted the device used in most English versions, rendering the name as Lord in capital letters to distinguish it from Adonai, another Hebrew word rendered Lord, for which small letters are used. Wherever the two names stand together in the Old Testament as a compound of God, they are rendered Sovereign Lord. Take heed. Listen. 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 Now notice that the English Bible correctly says that they substituted Lord and God for the Ibrit, the Hebrew name. Whereas others, like the King James versions, erroneously say that Lord and God are translations from the Hebrew. I want to make this abundantly clear. And if you think that you could prove me wrong, then attempt to do it. But you can't, because this is right knowledge. God and Lord are not translations of his name. Lord and God are substitutions for his name. I reiterate, God and Lord are not translations of his name. They're substitution. Now, how do we pronounce the YHWH or the Tetragrammaton? There are many people who acknowledge Yahuwah or Yahuwah is indeed the name of the Almighty, but then comes the issue of the pronunciation. The most common pronunciations are Jehovah and Yahweh, both of which are incorrect. That's a fact, bro. Jehovah is probably the most commonly and most traditionally pronounced for the name of the Father. And yet most people probably don't even know that Jehovah is actually derived from the letter J. See, many years ago, translators were not fully aware of the common Jewish practices in writing the name. So they mispronounced the name of good brother JD. As with most Hebrew words, the Y sound of Yud became a J sound in English. Just like substituting Jerusalem for Jerusalem. So Jerusalem became Jerusalem. The Jordan became Jordan. Huh? And Yesha became Jesse. The V sound in the modern Hebrew pronunciation of the third letter Vav. And the translator did not take into account that it is sometimes used as a vowel. So as for the vowel sound, the translators were not aware that when the Yahudim or the Hebrews, the Jews, had a tradition of using different vowels making for the name to remind themselves not to pronounce his name aloud. Why? for fear of breaking the third commandment. So they inserted the wrong vowel sound there on purpose. So the result became Jehovah. And this mispronunciation stuck as each new generation kept using this incorrect word. Don't believe me? Go and check it out for yourself. See the New English Bible photo that I have here. Jehovah originated as a gross mispronunciation of the Father's true name, of the Father's true Hebrew name. Now let's deal with the Yahweh. Yahweh is another popular name used. It's a little better attempt to pronounce the name, but it's still incorrect. See, the first part, Yah, is correct. This is why I say it's better, right? But here, the third letter, vowel, is used as a consonant. So in this case, a W, when it should actually have been a vowel. There's no W sound in the Ibrit. I want to make that abundantly clear. And so people that say Yahweh, I want to make it clear there is no W sound in the Ibrit. It's the ooh. Is why you hear Kahan Tazadaq say Yahweh. So the correct way to pronounce YH, what they had there is the W. Remember, the W is a transliteration. It wouldn't be there. A W comes from the U. So there would have been no W, and that U sound would have been the U sound. You see what I'm saying? Make sense? So the correct way to pronounce it is Yahuwah, Yahuwah, Yahuwah. Let's break it down. The first two letters, Yud, Hey, from Yah. Yud makes the Y sound. The second letter, Hey, Hey, closes the first syllables, making a barely discernible sound at the end, like a short exhale. Yah is shortened, is a short form of the name Yahuwah that is found several times in the scriptures. And so therefore, when pronouncing the YHWH, the first two letters are not separated. Yah stays intact as one syllable. So in other words, you say Yah, Yahuwah, Yahuwah, Yahuwah. So this short form of his name is found multiple times in the scriptures, such as in Isaiah, Isaiah 12 and 2, and in Tawahim, Psalms 68 and 4, and in the word Hallelujah. Giggle, giggle. See, it doesn't matter how you spell it. Hallelujah, Hallelujah, it's still pronounced Hallelujah, Yah. It has the Yah on the end. As you see, I have it right here. Hallelujah, right? Praise Yah. That means praise Yah. Behold, Yahuwah is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For Yah, the Adonai, is my strength and song. He also has become my salvation. That's Isaiah, Isaiah 12 and 2. Book of Tawahim 6 and 4. Sing to Yahuwah or Yahuwah. Sing praises to his name. Extol him who rides on the cloud. The third letter that they put there is the vowel. But it causes the most confusion in the pronunciation of the name. Vav makes a V sound. You know what I told you, JD? Vav makes a V sound, but is also used as a vowel, making either an ooh, 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 or an sound. What sound is correct, JD? See, many people in the scriptures have Hebrew names that contain the first two or three letters of the Father's name. Why? Because the pronunciation of these Hebrew names have been retained. And so, overwhelmingly agreed upon. So, over the years, and lets us know that the pronunciation of the Yuhei rather than the valve. So I want you to look at the screen right now, my good brother JD, and if it the valve sound will be there, this is how I'm going to dispel the valve sound, right? What? How do you pronounce the English transliteration of Judah in the Ibri? It will be Yahuda, Yahuda, Yahuda. You see, the first part of the Most High's name is there. Yahu. How come it's not built? Yahwah. You see what I'm saying? This is how the truth comes in, right here. So you pronounce it in English as Judah, but it's not pronounced with the vowel sound. It's pronounced with the as in Yahuda or Yeshaya, Isaiah. It's not pronounced with the W sound. You've been confounded. See, this is right knowledge for real. Kahan Tazadaq is one who was sent as a seer and a prophet to give you the truth to those that can receive it. Get out of your emotions and hear it, JD. As in Elijah, Eliyah, Elijah. Again, there's no vowel sound there. Or Yemiyahu, Jeremiah. Again, no vowel sound. So why are you trying to substitute it with a vowel sound in the name of the Father? It's a mistranslation. Or Yeshaya, Yeshua, Yeshaya, Yeshua, Yeshua, as in Josiah, Yeshua. None of those names are pronounced with that third letter, vowel, being a V sound. Why? Why? Or with a W sound. Why? So that sets aside the name Yehovah or Jehovah or Yahuwah. And it's, they're all pronounced with the ooh sound, as in Yahuwah. Praise be the Most High, man, for Kahan Tazadaq being sent to give you the correct me. See, none of those names are pronounced with the letter vowel being a V sound or a W sound. All of those names uses the U sound or the ooh, Yahuwah, Yahuwah sound. So the first two syllables of the Father's name, Yahuwah, Yahuwah. Ooh, Yahuwah, Yahuwah, as shown in the image. Praise be the Most High God, Tazadaq. Glory, glory, glory. Let the truth be lifted up. The fourth letter of the name is Hey. The Hey is virtually silent when it comes at the end of a word. Again, sounding like a short breath, barely heard. Exhale. So it takes the sound of a vowel, and hence the final syllable. Yahuwah, Yahuwah. And that brought the life in that. So there you have it. The name of the Almighty made clear, simple, and easy. Yahuwah. Now, just to confirm this, of course, Kahan Tazadaq went before Yahuwah. A Yah in prayer. This was something completely new to Kahan Tazadaq. So he had to be certain. Do you understand? Hallelujah. Tazadaq, but what can't? It don't matter. Don't matter what we say. It don't matter what we call on his name. People translate things. We could call him God. We could call him Lord. See, that's what the Christian says, because your spirit's off. So let me address that. Stephanie's mother said, oh yeah, well, don't matter what we can call him. People translate, that's ignorance. and ignorance is not bliss, and I'm here to give you the truth so you can lack it and understand it, believe it or not. And if you don't receive it, you're gonna be condemned. Many people say that God and Lord are just English translations for his name, and since we speak English, there's nothing wrong with saying God or Lord. Now in cipher, I mean, God knows our hearts anyway, all right? Right? That's what they say, right? Let me tell you, I'm going to make this clear. For all of you that keep trying to use that lie, let me dispel that lie. God or Lord are not translations of Yahuwah. Why? First of all, proper nouns, including names, are not translated. Names are given to a specific individual, and they're never translated or even changed to a different version. A name is a person's identity, and it doesn't change. Just look at the world news. Reporters do not translate foreign names, no matter how difficult it is to pronounce or how easy it is to come up with an English version. A person's identity does not change based on where one travels in the world. The name on your passport or your driver's license does not change just because you entered another country. Your name is your identity and will not change based on language that is spoken around you. Yahuwah is the Father's name. It is his personal identity. His name is not to be changed. Understand that. Lord and God are not even true translations. A translation conveys the meaning of a word, a phrase, into another language. Case in point, adios is translated as goodbye, adios, right? And shalom is translated as peace. The name Yahuwah does not have the same meaning as the word Lord and God. Yahuwah means I am. I was, I will be. Lord is a title that means master. It is not a name. It's like captain, senator, or doctor. They are all titles, but they are not actual names. Do you understand? Do you understand? Lord is actually used as a translation of the Hebrew word Adonai, even though master is a much better translation. Hallelujah. Now, the word God is also not a name. It is a description indicating the essence or nature. It's like saying human, man, woman, or child. They simply state one is, but they're not names. See, God is often used as a translation for the Hebrew word Elohim, or in the Paleo-Hebrew, Elohim. Now, although Elohim is actually better translated as stronger one or the mighty ones or the powers, you see? So Lord and God are not translations of the name. Lord and God were used in the place of Yahuwah. Yahuwah. They're substitutes, replacements, not simply an English version or translation of the name. Do you understand? Which part of that don't you get? Therefore, using the words Lord and God are incorrect usage in reference to the Father. Hallelujah. Furthermore, the word God is generic. Let me give you a brief story to explain what the foul mouth means by that. TC once told me how he met a group of friends for Bible study. And there was passerbys. Passerbys was curious and asked to join them in prayer. The passerbys, these newcomers, asked, who are we praying to? And they say, yo, we're praying to God. Then the newcomers asked, in a very sincere manner, which God? Now, oddly, this group with TC, of strong faith, fervent, those Christians, and they had no idea how to answer that question. And so therefore they tripped and they stumbled for an answer, only to finally say, the God of the Bible. Why? Because they were so unsure how to identify who they worship. So they almost posed it as a question. Most of you guys finished high school, right? Remember high school? When you had to study Greek and Roman mythology? How many gods and goddesses did you learn about? Or have you ever watched Jeopardy and caught the mythology category? How many different gods were there mentioned? What? Got a photo here on the right, what? See the photo on the right about these Greek gods? It's out of Kahan's library. It's entitled The Gods and Goddesses in Mythology. A myth is something that's not real. Do you understand what mythology is, sister? But you always calling yourself a goddess? Get your mind right, sis. See, that's a whole lot of gods to fill up 10 volumes, right? What about the Bible? Ever come across the names of different gods that the people around Israel worship? See, when I looked up the word God in the dictionary, the definition pertained to Judaism, Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, Christian, science, philosophy, and humanism, and New Age. See, if just about every religion on earth worship one that is called God, then how do they distinguish from one another? It's because they have names. Other religions may say God, but most of them still have distinct names or name to represent the one that they worship or the ones that they worship. How can it be the one true creator of the universe doesn't have a way to distinguish himself from all of their gods? The fact is, he does. He has a name. You just never knew it. But now you do. His name is Yahuwah. Yahuwah. Hallelujah. Yah. Now let's get back to Kahan Tazadaq and the good brother Darab. My name is Yahuwah, not Lord. Torah. Teachings of the Tanakh, commonly called the law, better referred to as instructions. Shemot, Exodus 3:15, and Elohim, Elohim, said further to Moshe, thus, you are to say to the children of Israel, Yasha'Allah, Elohim of your fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Yitzhak, and the Elohim of Yaakov has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my remembrance to all generations. Book of Shemot, Exodus 6:3. And I appeared to Abraham, to Yitzhak, and to Yaakov as El Shaddai, and by my name, Yahuwah, was I known to them. Book of Shemot, Exodus 9:16. And for this reason, I have raised you up in order to show you my power, and in order to declare my name in all the earth. Book of Shemot, Exodus 20:24. Make an altar of the earth for me, and you shall slaughter on it your burnt offerings and your peace offerings, your sheep and your cattle, in every place where I cause my name to be remembered. I shall call to you and bless you. Book of Shemot, Exodus 23:21. Be on guard before him and obey his voice. Do not rebel against him, for he is not going to pardon your transgressions, for my name is in him. Yahuwah, Leviticus 19:12. And do not swear falsely by my name, and so profane the name of your Elohim, or our Chaim. I am Yahuwah. Bamidbar, Numbers 6 and 27. Thus they shall put my name on the children of Israel, Yasha'Allah. Deuteronomy 18, verse 19. And it shall be, the man who does not listen to my words, which he speaks in my name, I will require it of him. Deuteronomy 18 and 20. But the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other mighty ones, even that prophet shall die. Thus saith Yahuwah Elohim.
You understand? In the Lashawam HaKadosh, Lashawam Kadosh, or the set apart tongue, or the holy tongue. When the word holy, when you look it up, set apart, the holy tongue. Lashawam Kadosh, holy tongue. This is what we're saying. We're speaking in the holy tongue. They're trying to tell you it's not a language to throw you off. So restoring the names. And this is what I say about Nate, man, over there in IUIC. How you not going to use the name of the Lord, man? That name carries a certain vibration. So how you not going to use the name of the Lord? It's because you so long 501c3. So restoring the names without distortions enables the listeners to experience the richness and the purity and the authenticity that flows from the unfiltered, inspired word in the Creator's mind. The key, the knowledge, is the personal name. So how do you have Nate not using the name? The personal name of the Creator, and using that name unlocks the message that would otherwise remain sealed. A name uniquely identifies being spoken of. The first known translation of Yahweh's word was made from Hebrew, into the Greek language between 285 to 246 BCE. You can't even call me a liar. Go and check it out. Matter of fact, let me put it in the word. I want you to go and check that out. What do they call that? For Lamech? What do they call that? Creation, brother, that is translation of the Greek. Ptolemic. That's what they call the creation from 285 to 246 BCE. Alexandria, Egypt. They done it in Alexandria, Egypt. Word Egypt is not even, that's a Greek word right there. You understand? You got people calling themselves Egyptologists, but you're using a Greek word. That shows you how confused they are. You see what I'm saying? Egypt itself is a Greek word. So that translation is often referred to as the Septuagint. I got one right in the room, man. I read all of these books, man. Septuagint meaning 70. Yeah, a lot of people, do this stuff, they don't know what they're talking about. I wonder why they call it the Septuagint. Think because the temple was finally destroyed in 70 AD. But when you look up the word Septuagint, it means 70. It's short for 70. It's Latin for 70, in other words. That's what Septuagint means. It's Latin for 70. So, and the reason that they named it that is because traditionally, it was assumed that 70 scribes were used to translate the Torah, which is actually the five books of Moses, into Greek. So when they did so, they left the name of the Most High, Elohim, Elohim, unmolested, as the translation also. So what you're holding in your knowledge right now, when you're listening to this message right now, and what you should be holding in your mind, is that the first time since 70, when the Septuagint, we're trying to, you know, bring the scriptures to you that does not leave out the original name as it appeared in the Ibrit, in the Hebrew. So the original autograph of the Creator is best shown used in the ancient primary letters he used to write his name when he wrote it with his finger in Mount Sinai and gave those tablets to Moses. And what was that name? It was Yahweh. And they pretend they don't know the name, right? How can they pretend they don't know the name? I want you to answer me this, good brother Barak. How can they say they don't know the name, but they came up with the Tetragrammaton? Yeah, how you gonna come up with the Tetragrammaton, but you don't know the name? So you have the H, which is the high sound, right? I mean, you have the Y, which is the Yah sound. Then you have the H, which is the high sound. So you in the Lashawam HaKadosh, the Lashawam Kadosh, the Y is Yah, right? The H is ha, 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 right? We're just dealing with phonetics. Then you have the wah, wah. See how they threw people off? They changed that W sound to a V. You understand? This is why some people call it Jehovah. You see what I'm saying? That's where Jehovah come from. That's how they threw that in the Bible. So if you don't understand the Hebrew, you don't really get it. So you have the Yah, ha, wah, they try and change that to a V later on, and then you have the ha at the end. And if you know anything about the Hebrew language, if the ha is at the end of the word, then you drop the A from it, so you just have an H. That's how we come up with Yahweh. You got camps that's calling it Ahaya. Ahaya is not a name. It's one of the many titles of the Most High. That's not a name. When he's given his name, he says the Lord God. That's his name, Yahweh. So the world has called, you know, this letter style, Phoenicians, right? They say we use the, is that not what they say? We use the language of the Phoenicians. Isn't that what they say? That's what Egyptologists are saying. Not realizing the label of the Phoenicians was actually bestowed upon the Israelites by the Greek writers. They don't know history. I'm a historian as well. See, that's the thing. People, they see me studying the law all the time. They don't know I've been studying history for years, science, mathematics, everything. A true adept. You understand? I'm not right. It's just what I do. You understand? That's just what I do, man. So they don't know when they say, oh, you're using the Phoenician language. The word, this was actually bestowed upon the Israelites by Greek writers. A word meaning date palm. When you look it up, it means date palm in Greek. You see what I'm saying? So the word phoenix, which is Latin, ponas, means the same thing as the later Roman Empire converted this word to Punic, right? When they were actually battling the Israelite enemies at Carthage. You understand? So the Israelites have been called many things by the land umpires over the ages, such as Carthaginians, right? They didn't know that was us. You see what I'm saying? They think that was them. Carthaginians, but Phoenicians, but they're best known as the people of the sea. The Israelites dwell in the land given to them by Yahweh. However, we are more of a sea umpire. Tell us what you mean. What are you talking about? See, we're more of a sea umpire than a land umpire. So when you see other sources describing the script, like, you know, you see, I don't have an example of it. Let me see if I can throw an example up. I don't know if I have anything here with the Most High's name in it that I could upload real quick. me one second. Let me see if I got something I can share. So people listening on YouTube can see this. Let me see if I can pull up his name real quick. Share it in the room. So someone can speak for a minute while I'm looking for something to show the Most High's name here. Speak for a minute. Art, you got anything you want to bring out? Anything you want to say? Or share the door? You got anything you want to say?
God, I was just going to say real quick, when you know, even when you look on the, like certain ancient artifacts, the Most High's name is grafted in the certain artifacts, like I believe it's on the Moabite stella, right, Kahan? It's on the, you know, a bunch of like the Long Island inscription. You got the back crease, the back creek stone, and what have you, you know, so. The name does exist. This is something that's tangible. That it can't you can't get around it.
Cut. Most definitely. I know I had something here. Got the Lord's name in it.
And so, too, to say, when you look at, you know, certain verses, like in Exodus chapter 6, verse 3, it says, "And I appeared unto Abraham and unto Isaac and unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty." So the translation in the Hebrew is Allah Shaddai. It says, "But by my name, Yahweh, was I not known to them." So this was like after some time, however, yet and still, this was the name that Israel knew, was the so-called YHW, H in the English letters, but the Yah, Ha, Wah, and then the Hi at the end, and you drop the A.
Cunt.
That same scripture is also evident in, Exodus chapter 15, verse 3, where he says, "The Lord," where it says, "The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name." And, you know, again, looking at Hebrew, that's Yahweh.
Right. Yeah. Whenever he's using that, the Lord or the Lord God, it's literally saying Yahweh. It's not saying Ahaya. That's how you know it's the name of the Most High, man. When it's using the name Ahaya, it's just giving it a title. That's one of his many titles. You got anything, Shenador?
Well, I was just trying to figure out. I know the letter J is only about 200 to 300, well, probably about 300-400 years old. I just don't remember the reference for that material, but yeah, that letter J is something they brought into practice once they tried to conquer the Americas, to keep us confused because they already knew who we were. So just to just to back up your point of Jehovah, that never existed until after 1492.
Find anything.
But today's message is good though. It's heavy.
I hear a lot of Israelites use Yahuwah.
You said you're looking for some
He wrote it. Yeah.
Well, I didn't finish it. I stopped at Yah right there. I was going to keep going. However, yeah, that's the what they would call in modern Hebrew, the Aleph. Absent of the diacritic mark is ah.
Mm-hmm.
Because those are like the sounds that, just like the Kahan said once before, when babies come out, that's why they have such a high degree of intelligence. If they come out, making certain sounds that's that correspond with this here.
Kahan. You can already pronounce it.
Kahan. I finish writing it out.
Yeah, I was actually doing a book on that. I stopped it a few years ago. I was putting together a book with the Lashawam HaKadosh. Yeah, I got to get back onto it. Yeah, we got to start doing some like private like Hebrew classes, man. Yeah, like you know, on the Zoom. But yeah, I think I found something right here. I'll let people see this right here. Give me a second.
Yeah, I started to learn it, but on that those learning apps, they aren't consistent with some of the historic resources, so I just cut it out.
Yeah, some of that. You know, I mean, Esau is involved there, you know? And so, you know, when they start to add the vowels and, you know, and they would say, well, without the vowels, it's not language, and yeah, that's not Hebrew. And that, yeah, okay, man, well, you're entitled to that. Well, we'll speak it amongst ourselves, because you're not supposed to be speaking it anyways. It's not given to you. That's how they came up with this stuff they call Hebrew, and they're really speaking Yiddish, because they got a German dialect mixed in it.
Yeah, that was one of my questions. Where do we learn our language? Is there a reference point one could go to?
You learn right here with Fife.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, but I have plenty of sources on that, man. But you learn right here. I mean, and we study and sometimes I'll use it in videos a little bit. You know what I'm saying? Mashallah. Like, in fact, in Hebrew, you don't talk to men and women the same way. Hebrew is gender specific, right? If I say how are you to a man, I'm not going to say it the same way to a woman. You know, it's gender specific. That's one of the unique things about the language itself. If I come in, Atame Vini Vri. Do you speak Hebrew? If I said it to a female, I wouldn't say it that way. I'd say, Ah, me vini vri. Ah, me vini vri. Atame vini vri. Ah, me vini vri. See, it's different to when you're talking to the woman and when you're talking to the man. The words, it's not like the English language. Certain words are totally, so if I, even the word understand would change, right? If I said it to a female, or do you speak would change. Mavina, I say that to a female. To a male, I would say Mavini. You see? So, I mean, the language is very, very specific and precise, man.
So through studying, what I've come to see is that once the word of God has been translated, it actually leaves more room for confusion with each translation, because in the original tongue, it's really hard to, it doesn't leave that much to interpretation under the original tongue. But when they took it from that, that's where it gave a veil of possible deception, you know, and whatnot. So that's one of the things that prompted me to want to learn, you know, some years back. It's like, I think I've said this before, but when I started to learn in the lexicon and the concordance what the original meaning of words are, like when you see the word heart, you know, in the Bible, it has absolutely nothing to do with what's beating in your chest, but, you know, the soul of your mind.
All right.
Go ahead. Oh, yeah. Oh, that's good. I like that. I'm going to snapshot that right quick. Need that.
All right. So can everyone see this right here?
I got it.
God.
Yeah, I see it.
Now, the brother William, who was that? It was William or, hold on, who's this message? Chat message. Oh, yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
I
want to say real quick, too. I think when it, you know, for some of the brothers, you know, depending on what type of doctrine they're following behind, if they pronounce it at a certain speed, you know, you would kind of hear that pronunciation a little bit, For instance, you know, we say Yahweh. Now, if you said, you know, speeding it up, Yahweh, like that.
Yeah, so you kind of
hear the U in there. However, it's still not a U. It's just at a quickened pace. Yahweh, right. Yahweh, like that.
Yeah. So is this really dialect? You see what I'm saying? Because the dialect was changed everywhere that we move. So you see right here, this is real Pelier Hebrew. Ah, ba, ga, da, ha, wa, za, ka, ta. Now some people will spell you know, ta like that, or they will right here, taza da, right here, right down here, taza, or ta, right? Ya, ka, la, ma, na, sha, ayin. It's pronounced from this is a chata sound from the back of your throat. It's not an I like in English. It's chayin, chayin. It comes from the back of your throat. Then pa, taza, ka, ra, sha. And so, I mean, that's what it is, man. That's what it is. I'm beginning in the spirit sometimes, man. But nevertheless, man, so the Phoenicians is essentially our language. So the Israelites, now this is what people don't understand. Let's go into a little bit of history about it, right? So you could better understand this term, you know, applies to the Israelite empire as it is known to the Greeks, right? So the Israel made allies with Tyre and Sidon, causing the northern 10 tribes to fall to Baal worship. Now, if you know anything about the nation of Israel, right? With the fall of King Solomon, the nation divided into two kingdoms. The northern kingdom retained the name Israel. The southern kingdom became known as Judah, right? So the northern kingdom consisted of 10 tribes and about 1/4 of Levi, who was a priest at the time. The southern kingdom consisted of Judah and Benjamin. And this history is important to know, man, in case someone asks you. So that northern kingdom went astray first, so-called Hispanics and so on and so forth. They went astray first. You know what I mean? Like what, about 200 and some years before the southern kingdom went astray. So they started for worshiping Baal, worshiping idols, and was scattered into the nations by the Assyrian Empire in 722 BCE. Don't believe me? Circa 722 BCE. Don't believe me though? Go and check it out for yourself. Go and check it out for yourself. And you know, for a hope, you know, someone's actually writing this stuff down so you can actually learn and research it yourself, because they're not gonna teach you this in your churches. They just won't. So the Israelites call the land of Canaan before they conquered it, and a small part of it was known as Philistia, right? Which the Romans later adopted into their form as Palestine. See how they changed things around? It is commonly thought that the Israelites adopted their alphabet, that they call the alphabet, right? From the ancient Canaanites, right? The Biblos, Tyre, Sidon. But reverse is the case. When you have Israelites debating with these Egyptologists, most of the Israelites, they really don't know history. They just claim to know. So the Egyptologists, it comes from the Biblos. That's a damn lie. That's a lie. The reverse is the case. What they now call the Semitic language. Someone got some noise in the background. Could you mute yourself? What they now call the Semitic language was actually the Shemitic language. And the Shemitic language and 22-letter alphabet was common to all descendants of Shem. Shem gives the term Shemite, losing the SH sound. This is what the people that's calling themselves Jews now refer to as Semites. How did they come up with that term? How did it go from Shem to Sem? It's because they passed it through the Greek. So when they passed it through the Greek, they lost the Shemite and it became Semite. They lost the SH sound by passing it through the Greek language and becoming Semite. So now they say you're anti-Semitic. So what is the message? The Basora, the message, is the answer to mankind's oldest mystery. What is the meaning of life? And it's simply love. From the beginning to the end, the Creator has pleaded and searched it hard and repeated himself beyond measure for Yasha Allah, you know, and for his return. He who has ears, let him hear. He said, love me and guard my commandments. The word light, wisdom, living water, and his covenant are all one and the same thing. The Torah of Yahweh wa Yahweh Shah. The Mashiach of Israel told the elders of Israel, if you do not believe when I speak to you about earthly things, how are you going to believe when I speak to you about heavenly things? Did he say it, Barak? Did the Lord say that?
Not kind.
And no one has gone up into heaven except he who came down from heaven, the son of Adam. He said, hold up, Tazadaq, that's blasphemy. The son of Adam. Is that blasphemy? Is that blasphemy, Shenador? No, it's just the son of man, the son of Adam. Understand it with thy readers. The son of Adam, meaning the son of man. Adam. And as Moshe lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the son of Adam, Adam, man, be lifted up, so that whosoever believe in him should not perish, but possess, they changed the word to have, but possess everlasting life. For Yahweh so loved the world that he gave his only protected son, so that everyone who believed in him should not perish, but possess everlasting life. For Yahweh did not send his son into the world to judge the world, but the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him is not judged, but he who does not believe in him is judged already. Who said that? What scripture is that? He that do not believe in him is judged already. Anyone know what scripture that is? You know what scripture that is, Brother Will? Anyone? He who do not believe in him is judged already. Anyone know the scripture?
Salaki, is that, that's somewhere, I believe it's in Matthew. Come,
let's get the book of John chapter 3, verse 18. People read John 3:16 already. You think Christians would notice, right?
Lucky.
You think Christians would notice. They, and this is what they do. They read John 3:16 and they stop. They stop. Let's get John 3:18.
Come, this is the book of John, chapter 3, verse 18. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because
just
he has...
Come, okay.
Because he have not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God.
Come. So you already judge. What does a lot of people say?
You can't judge me, brother. You shouldn't be judged. You can't judge me, brother.
Don't judge me. What does the scripture say about a spiritual man, though?
A spiritual kind. That's pursuant to...
Yeah, we ready to...
Spiritual man judges all things, but he himself is judge of no man.
What verse you read? Tell him the verse, huh?
That First Corinthians, Salakia. That John chapter...
That is First Corinthians. I mean, Senador. He that is spiritual judge all things. Read that again, huh?
Oh, I just... bit that off from the top of my head. I don't.
We gotta put that. We gotta put that in the scripture so they will know where to go to get it, man.
That's right. That's 1 Corinthians, I believe it's 6.
Nah, it's 2 and 15. 2 and 15.
1 Corinthians 2:15. But he that is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is judged of no man.
So what is Tupac talking about, only God could judge me? When the Lord sent through his prophet, he that is spiritual judges all things, but is judged by no man. So judgment is already written, man. We just read it. If you don't believe Hamashiach Yahawashah, your judgment is already written, meaning you're not going to make it. You're going to be written in the earth. He who believes in him is not judged, but he who does not believe is judged already, because he does not believe in the name of only begotten Son of Yahweh. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world and men love the darkness rather than the light, for their works were evil. Men love darkness, man. They love living in darkness. You see it by the people that didn't show up for this Bible study, man. For everyone who practices evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his works should be exposed. That's why they want to stay in darkness. But the one doing the truth comes to the light, so that his works are clearly seen, that they have been walk to Yahweh. That's the book of Yochanan 3. Someone get Yochanan 3rd chapter. Well, you're still in that same chapter right there. John. And he himself is atoning slaughter for our sins and for ours only. So you got that?
John the 3rd chapter. What verse you want to come up?
Let's start reading from the top of it.
God. This is John chapter 3, verse 1. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Yahawashah by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest, except God be with him. Yahawashah answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Verse 4, Nicodemus said unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Yahawashah answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said.
We could start right there. We could start right there. So, you know, there's a restoration taking place across the face of the earth, right? And the key is knowledge, right knowledge, that has actually been withheld, is now being revealed again, and it is turning the world upside down. That's Bible prophecy. Someone get on Book of Exodus 31 and 18. And so we learned that on Mount Sinai, the Creator, Yahweh, engraved 2 stone tablets with his finger and gave them to Moshe, Moses. He engraved his name using 4 ancient Hebrew letters. This is what we was going over. Yah, Ha, Wah. The Yah, the Ha,
Exodus 31.
And the Ha. Exodus 31 and 18. This name is often represented by Latin letters with the YHWH. That tells us what the name is right there. They put it in Latin, but all we have to do is go to the Paleo Hebrew. So we got the YHWH. We got the Yah, we got the Ha, we got the Wah, and we got the Ha. Yahweh. That's his name. In the original form, they appeared like I put on the screen earlier. Go ahead, Shenador, read what you got.
Exodus 31, 18, and he gave unto Moses, or Moshe, when he had made an end of communing with them upon Mount Sinai, 2 tables of testimony, tables of stone written with the finger of God.
Carter, that's what I was just talking about.
You want me to go on to 32 and 1?
Go ahead.
And when the people saw that Moshe delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, Up, make us gods which ye shall go before us, for as...
Nah, that's going to something else. That's talking about
okay. The clowns. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, so...
The cat, all right, yeah.
Let me put this on the screen again while we speak it here so people can take a snapshot of it, whatever you want to do, man. Put this on the screen here. Share my screen again, right there. All right. Can everyone see that?
Come
on.
Yeah. I wanna so real quick.
I got a quick question. Let me get a chance.
Go ahead, huh?
That eighth character and that 11th character, how do you pronounce those?
The eighth character, you know, that we see, that some, you know, people might refer to as a letter. It's like how Kahan was saying earlier with the 16th character, you know, you kind of pronounce it with like the back of your throat. So the eighth
character,
Kahan, the eighth character would be ha, like that. And then the 11th character would be just regular ka.
Sure. Got it. Yeah, it's much, much different than Spanish and English and French. Gotcha. I'm definitely going to get up on that.
By the way, thanks for the donation. YouTube, I appreciate that. So, you know, let's get back to this. Continue on the Lord's Most High. So, now, Kit, hopefully you can't see this other stuff on the screen. There's so much stuff on the screen here. Hey, so the only thing you guys see on my screen is the Paleo Hebrew sound.
Oh.
Images and everything. You guys, as pictures, like you see me on your screen, I got you guys on my screen also. So. So, what was that tool? All right. So, yeah, the Most High engraved his name using the four Hebrew letters that we went over. The name is often represented now in Latin by the YHWH, and that's how we come up with the name. That's what people think of it. They're trying to say no one knows the name, but Yahweh did not write in Babylonian script. That's actually now modern Hebrew, right? The Most High didn't write. He didn't write his name in that. What they're calling like the modern Hebrew. He wrote his name in the Paleo Hebrew, in the ancient Paleo or the primary Hebrew, so that, you know. And this is actually consistent throughout the scriptures, right? It's consistent in the handwriting in which the Most High wrote it in. And this was actually inspired, you know, by the prophets. So it's important to understand that the ancient Paleo Hebrew letters sound the same, though they look, you know, drastically different from the modern Hebrew, right? But the Babylonian script, more commonly seen today in the book of Yeshaya 34 and 16, admonishes to seek the book scroll of Yahweh. And in the scroll, you know, we find the name written in ancient Paleo Hebrew. So how do we come to embrace the Babylonian script known as modern Hebrew? The house of Yahawadah, which the same people, Brother Eliezer, you see the same people that will use the term Yahuda instead of Yahawadah. The house of Yahawadah was actually, you know, the house of Judah, to the, those that understand, right? Was taken into captivity to the Babylonians in 586. Understand this. This is how we start using this modernized script. So remember, the northern tribes went into captivity in 722. So later in 586 BCE, the southern tribe was actually taken into captivity by the Babylonians. And so upon our release after 70 years, they brought back from Babylon letters sheet we now refer to as modern Hebrew. We didn't have that before we went into Babylon. Understand that. So, and every time, you know, we went into other nations, different dialects came out. So about half the book of Daniel, one of the Babylonian captives, is written in the original Hebrew, and the rest is in the Babylonian script. So that's about 400 BCE. The scribe Ezra also adapted the square form of the Babylonian Hebrew that we actually see today. So as scrolls actually would wear out, the scribes actually copy the scrolls in the newer Babylonian shapes for the general text. But one word was faithfully preserved in its original form. Can anyone guess what that word is?
Yahweh.
You guessed it. You guessed it. So when they came to the name, they carefully preserved the Paleo Hebrew name, Yahweh. So why is Nate not saying the name? Why is Nate not saying Yahweh? Why Yahweh Shah? They preserved it in its authentic form. So why do we have people that's calling themselves Jews today? Oh, no one can say the name. It's too sacred. It's been preserved. It's a historical fact that the name has actually been preserved. So this word is actually used over 7,000 times in the Tanakh. Everyone knows what Tanakh is? Hey, Brother William, you still with us?
I'm here.
Williams, you still with us?
Yes, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yeah. So, you know what the Tanakh is, good brother?
I'm here.
Does everyone know what the Tanakh is? This is not to shame, you know, anyone down. It's to make sure that you know, right? Does everyone know what the Tanakh is? I need to be clear that everyone knows what this stuff is, because without you telling me, I don't know. I'm going to just keep going.
I don't know what the Tanakh is. Pardon me. I keep getting kicked out the room, but I don't know what the Tanakh is.
All right. Anyone, you want to tell them what the Tanakh is, though?
Kahan, the Tanakh, it simply means, it means, you know, in the Hebrew, teachers, writings, prophets.
Right. So in the Bible, you have the five books of Moses. That's what they call the Torah. And unlike most people say, the word Torah doesn't
That's
mean
right.
Yeah. So you the first five books of Moses is the Torah, and then you have the Tanakh, which is considered to be the writing of the prophets. Can someone mute that, where that noise is coming from? So, nevertheless, so the name Yahweh is mentioned over 7,000 times in the Tanakh. So with that being said, how can people like GLCC confuse a name? They're saying the name of the Most High is Ahayah. How come it's not mentioned over 7,000 times in the Tanakh? You see the title I Am how many times? Not nowhere near 7,000 times, man. So we also know that the earliest copies of the Septuagint, meaning 70, when we look it up in the Latin. Who's that putting his messages? Lost some space. Small chain of thought. So, you know, we also know that the earliest copies of the Septuagint, which means 70, when you look it up in the Latin, translations into Greek preserve the Paleo Hebrew form of Yahweh's name. Whereas the later copies use the Greek word Lord. And this is where the English Bible translation has the word Lord there. Everyone got that?
Kahan.
Corius. Lord. Kahan. Replaced it. So, you know, by replacing it, they wiped it out. So now when you read the English translation of the King James, you see the word Lord there. So the 70, which is the Septuagint, when you read it in Latin, translated the spelling of Yahawashah to Yahshua, Joshua. You understand? And to the Greek, Jesus. And this is how they come up with Jesus. I-E-S-O-U-S. That's how they come up with Jesus. Totally changed it. They totally changed it. So the Greek letters, I-E-O-U-S, for the successor of Moshe. So those who rely on this evidence that it is acceptable to allow the Greek form to triumph over the original Hebrew are simply in error. They're just totally in error. It is corruption. The Greek alphabet is unable to convey the correct sounds of certain Hebrew letters because it has no sh sound. The Greek doesn't have the sh sound. It doesn't have the sh sound. And it doesn't have the y sound. So this is how now when you get to Yahweh, the Greeks put the V in there and they put the J. So now you got Jehovah instead of Yahweh. You understand? So the third commandment in the book of Exodus 20 verse 7. Can you get that up? Exodus 20 verse 7.
Kahan. This is the book of Exodus chapter 20 verse 7. Thou shalt not take the name of the Most High thy power in vain.
Kahan. So in other words, it's saying, Greg, finish that one out?
For the Most High will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain.
Okay, so it's saying, thou shalt not show off, meaning to destroy his name. When you take his name in vain, it's sha'ah, meaning to destroy. So thou shalt not destroy the Most High's name. So why is Nate calling him Jesus? Why won't say the name Yahawashah? They know the name.
God, I remember that one, and I remember that in the Hebrew too. La'a tasha'a atshum Yahawah Allahayka lashawa'a kaya la'a yanakwa Yahawah at ashar yasha'a atshamwa lashawa'a. That's it in the Hebrew.
Come. The water. So his name, or don't destroy his name, or don't cast his name to ruin. Yet by denying or avoiding Yahweh and Yahawashah's name, you know, the Yahweh's name and the name of his son, Yahawashah, both Judaism and Christianity has done exactly that. Breaking the third command. So while in Babylon, the house of Yahawadah was enslaved, they heard the Babylonians using the name in disrespectful ways, profaning it. So to help prevent this from happening, those in leadership put into effect a ban against pronouncing the name. This is where the Tetragrammaton comes into place. They say, hey, don't use the Most High's name, it's too sacred, because these heathens was desecrating the name of the Lord. You understand? So they ban against pronouncing the Lord's name. This is why we're not just supposed to say the name to just anyone, man. We share this name with Yasha'Allah. So they put a ban against pronouncing the Most High's name, Yahweh, declaring it to be sacred. By never saying the name, it quickly became unknown to the Yahudim, right? So this ban is completely contrary to the scriptures. They weren't supposed to do that. Yahweh commands us over and over again in the scriptures to utter and proclaim and lift up his name in authentic Hebrew. Nate, you're going to start teaching the name again, Nate. You're going to start teaching the name because you know the name. The Most High tells us to use the name. This is why we had to kick, man. And I take this very serious because one guy come in here, some young cat. We don't have to say the name of the Most High. Then he try and pull something in the Book of Revelations and say he will give, you know, he will tell us his name. Well, we know the name of the Lord. He already told us that. The revelations is the things to come. But right now we know the name of the Most High and we're supposed to do it. You understand? So people are saying we're not supposed to say the name. That's off, man. That's off. His name is paramount. What? His name is paramount. It says proclaim and lift up his authentic Hebrew name. It is paramount. It is important to understand that if we continue to use counterfeits like Jesus, like whatever else they call De Jesus, whatever else states they call him, and they call him by all kind of things, man. You know, nevertheless, we're supposed to use the sacred name, Yahweh Shah. We're not supposed to use counterfeits, names, or devices for the Father and his Son. So, this is true, man. We will not be in true worship. Like Nate and them, this is why they got 501c3 grant. No matter how many followers they got, we will not be in true worship unless we say in his name, man. Nor truly will we know who we serve when we leave ourselves open for the enemy to step in as the author of confusion and deceive us. Yahweh Shah mentioned that they had taken away the key of knowledge. The Lord said that. Let's get that, man. The book of Barashara, the book of Luke, 11 and 52. It's the message. Luke 11 and 52.
God, this is the book of Luke, chapter 11, verse 52. Woe unto you, lawyers, for ye have taken away the key of knowledge.
Yeah, they taken away the key of knowledge. The Lord said they taken away the key of knowledge. That's what's going on in this system, man. Kind tracks, man, ruining people's lives, turning people into straw people, a straw man. Lord said destruction unto you, man. So we find in the book of Genesis 4:26, someone get that please, that Yahweh's name began to be called upon and continued to be called upon up and during the time of the first temple period. So when the house of Yahweh was taken into captivity into Babylon, the pagan Babylonian influences took a firm grip on their hearts and their minds. Now, in modern translations, we see the results of this ban of his sacred name and the fact that Yahweh's name has been entirely omitted and replaced with titles or terms which can apply to any pagan deity. Almost 70,000 times, or at least 7,000. All right, read what you got, huh?
Okay, you said the book of Exodus chapter 4, verse 6?
26. Exodus 4:26.
The book of Exodus chapter 4, verse 26. Salakia. That's the one, Kahan?
Kahan.
Okay, this is the book of Exodus chapter 4, verse 26. So he let him go. Then she said, a bloody husband thou art because of the circumcision. Is that the right one?
No, Salakia, my bad. I mean, I wanted Genesis 4:26. My bad. Yeah. My bad.
Salakia.
My bad.
Wrong scripture. Salakia. This is the book of Genesis, chapter 4, verse 26. And, this is the book of Genesis, chapter 4, verse 26.
Come.
And to Seth. To him also there was born a son, and he called his name Enos, and began men to call upon the name of the Lord.
See that? The Lord right there is supposed to say Yahweh. Yeah, they begin to call on the name of Yahweh. Right? So they done replaced that with the Lord. and they replaced that so many times in the Bible. So they're not using a sacred name. And so when you're not using a sacred name, it's not sound doctrine. And you know, the new translations, they don't use the Most High's name. They don't use the Son's name. They're not using the original Hebrew name, but they know the name. The name was actually preserved, man. So, the original name, again, you know, has been taken out. Now, the second century BCE, the first translation from the Hebrew to the Greek being named the Septuagint, and this is actually abbreviated again with the Latin letters LXX, which in the Roman numerals is 7, Septuagint, right? Book of Proverbs 30, verse 4, let's get that. It asks us a crucial question. I want Nate and everyone out there that's not using the name of the Most High, that's thinking it's okay to call him Jesus, to answer this question that the book of Proverbs 30, verse 4 is asking us.
God, this is the book of Proverbs, chapter 30, verse 4. Who hath descended up into heaven or descended?
Stop. Let's stop for a second. Let's get some understanding. Hey, my brother Ricky, who has ascended up to heaven and descended? That's Yahweh Shah, right? And he ascended up to the heaven and he came down. That's Yahweh Shah. Read on.
God, or descended. Who hath gathered the wind in his fists?
That's Yahweh. He gathered the wind in his fists and he created everything. God.
Who hath bound the waters in a garment?
Read.
Who hath established all the ends of the earth? What is his name? And what is his son's name, if thou canst tell?
Come, what is his name? What is his son's name, if thou canst tell? So we're supposed to be calling on the Lord's name. And he's asking you, what is his name? This is a relevant question. What is his name? What is his son's name, if thou canst tell? What's the name of the Most High? Yahweh. Why Yahweh Shah? What is his name and what his son's name? Now, these so-called rabbis in Judaism calls Yahweh the substitute term Hashem, Adonia, or Elohim. Those are substitutes. That's not the name of the Lord, man. That's not the name of the Most High. You ever notice when they bless? When someone sneezes, they say, Hashem, meaning his name, Hashem, Elohim. None of these are his names. They're just titles. Like Ahaya, that GLCC says, that's not the Lord's name, man. That's not what he's given a name. That's a title. Who shall I tell him that sent me? I am. That's a title. That's not the Lord's name. These are titles. These are pronouns. Now in Christianity, like the guy last night, right? He kept using Jehovah. Jehovah. They use Jehovah for the Father and Jesus for the Son. Is that not what he was using? Stop me from lying. He was using Jehovah for the Father and Jesus for the Son. Both are what's not authentic. They are imprinted with the corruption found in Greek and Latin alphabets. The names can't be Jehovah or Jesus. Now, don't tell me it's not important, man. This is very important because the Lord told you to use his name. You're going to use his name, man. Because there's no letter J, as my good Oxenador was bringing out in the Ibrit, in Hebrew. The letter J appeared on earth during the 16th century. The 16th century. The Greek added the ending letters S to the name of Yahweh Shah. They call it Yahshua, right? Yahshua. So another term, God, right? G-O-D. Black man said, I'm God. I'm peace God. Okay. This has actually come to replace the original Ibrit word, Elohim, or Elohim. Read the book. Let's get the book of Exodus 23 and 13 to prove all things. You're going to get this Besorah today. You're going to get this Besorah today. Exodus 23 and 13. Someone going to get that? Senator, you still with us? Huh?
Exodus 23:13, and read, "And in all things that I have said unto you, be circumspect, and make no mention of the names of other gods, neither let it be heard."
Stop for a second, because Nate is not getting this. A lot of Israelites are not getting this, and they call themselves elders. I need you to read that part again, brother, and read it slow. Make no mention of any names of other gods. We're not calling on God. We're not calling on Jesus. We're not calling on God. We're calling on Yahweh, Yahweh Shah. That's the name. You're going to say the name, man. You're going to say the Lord's name, man. Or you're going to miss the message. The Spirit's not going to rush upon you. You're not saying the Lord's name. Read that, brother.
"And in all things that I have said unto you, be circumspect, and make no mention of the name of other gods."
So we're not supposed to make the mention of names of any other god. That's blasphemy, man. That's blasphemy. Read it for yourselves. Since you think we got some made-up Bible or something like that. So with that scripture in mind, right? With that scripture in mind, why don't you consider this right here, right? That is what the Encyclopedia America 1945 edition says under the topic God, right? Word for personal objective of religious worship, formally applicable to superhuman beings of heathen myth. On conversion, races to Christianity, the term was applied to supreme being. So when we use that word God, when you look at the American Encyclopedia 1945 edition, it says that the word God was worship formally applicable to superhuman beings of heathen myth. You understand? So when we use God and we don't use Yahweh, Yahweh Shah, we're talking about heathens. What did you just read, Senator? Don't call on any other gods. Let's get the book of 1 Thessalonians 5:22. It warns us not to give the appearance of evil, and this would actually have to include what comes from our mouths. Guile is deceit. So when we speak guile using replacement names or use titles like Ahaya in place of his name, Yahweh, we are breaking the third commandment and giving the appearance of evil in our speech. We are we're circulating, which means talking around the name. This is what Nate does all the time, but not really saying it. He knows who we mean. That's what they commonly say, right? Well, the Lord knows. Many say they don't use the name because they don't want to keep offending people. They don't offending Yahweh, but they don't want to offend people. I mean, what you want to think about that? You don't want to offend people, but you don't mind offending Yahweh or Yahweh Shah, so you won't use the name. I mean, someone please help me. Why is IUIC not using a name? What's the big thing about not using a name if you know the name? Numbers 6 and 24 through 27, right? It talks about Yahweh's name will be upon his people. Let's get that. And we're going to bring some stuff to light today. It said his name was be upon his people, man. So we're supposed to be using a name. They can't get away with not using a name, man.
You want to drop 1 Thessalonians chapter 5? 22?
Yeah, you can bring that out real quick. You can bring that out real quick.
The book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 22, abstain from all appearance of evil.
Come on. Now let's go to the book of Numbers.
Numbers, you said chapter, you know, remember
Numbers
one?
6, 24 through 27.
Got it. 6:24. Okay, this is the book of Numbers chapter 6, verses 24. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Most High make his face shine upon thee.
Okay, stop. So when we read that in the Ibrit, that word Lord is what? It's Yahweh. Yahweh bless thee and keep thee. So it's not a higher. That's not the Lord's name, man. It's not saying I am there. It's saying the Lord. That's when the Most High was given his name, man. When he said the Lord God. This is my name forever. He wasn't talking about the title or higher. It says the Lord, it says Yahweh bless and keep thee. Read on.
It says, the Most High make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. Verse 26, the Most High lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Verse 27, and they shall put my name upon the children of Israel and I will bless them.
Okay, what name would that be? What name would that be? Let's get Genesis 4 and 26. What name would that be? The name would be the Lord, which is Yahweh, not Ahayah. The name would be the Lord, which is Yahweh. Genesis 4 and 26. Read what you got.
And to Seth, to him also, there was born a son, and he called his name Enos. Then began men to call upon the name of Yahweh.
Yahweh. Yahweh. So Ahayah is not there, man. The higher is not there. They're telling you the Lord's name that we're supposed to call on, man. This is only one. This is the only name given under heaven. Let's get the book of Acts 4 and 12. And then we go to the book of 1 Kings 18 and 24. We found that Elijah called on the name of Yahweh while the pagans called on the names of their deities. But ow! Someone got that? Acts 4 and 12. Someone get
Acts 4 and 12.
John, I got it. It's the book of Acts, chapter 4, verse 12. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men.
So how are they going to say you can't use the name when the Lord is telling you right there through the Apostle Paul, neither is there salvation in any other. So you got to use the name, man. You got to use the name. Let's get 1 Kings 18:24. 1 Kings 18:24, we find out that Elijah called on the name of Yahweh while the pagans called on the name of their deities, Baal, and all these other deities. So clearly there must be a distinction in what we call our creator. If not, how come Elijah didn't just call on Baal? When they say the name don't matter, right? So it shouldn't matter if we call him Baal. You see what I'm saying? It don't make any sense, man.
1 Kings 18:24, and called ye on the name of your gods, and I will call on the name of Yahweh, and the God that answers by fire, let him be God. And all the people answered and said, it is well spoken. 25, and Elijah said unto the prophets of Baal, choose you one bullock for yourselves and dress it first, for ye are many, and call on the name of your gods, but put no fire under.
Come, stop. So does anyone knows what that word Baal means in the Hebrew? It means Lord. So how come we're not calling on that then? You understand? It means Lord. Don't believe me? Go and check it out for yourself. Go and get a Hebrew Bible dictionary. The word Baal means Lord. So how come we're not using, how come we're not saying Baal then? You see what I'm saying? So the name is important. You following people saying that the name's not important, then it's gonna get you caught up, man. It's gonna get you caught up. Baal in Hebrew means Lord. So clearly Lord is not the true name we should be calling upon. Let's get the book of Deuteronomy 28 and 10. Deuteronomy 28 and 10. Deuteronomy 28 verse 10.
Deuteronomy chapter 28 verse 10.
And let's get Revelation 22 verse 4.
And it reads, and all people of the earth shall see that thou art called by the name of the Lord, Yahweh, and they shall be afraid of thee.
See that? It doesn't say Ahayah. It says Yahweh.
Salakia, this is the book of Revelation, chapter 22. Salakia, verse 4.
Come.
And they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads.
Okay, so let's see what name should be on our foreheads. What should that name be? Let's get Malachi 3 and 16. Malachi 3 and 16.
It's the book of Malachi, chapter 3, verse 16. Then they that feared the Most High spake often, one to another, and the Most High hearkened, and Yahweh hearkened, and heard it. And a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared Yahweh. And that thought upon his name.
So we supposed to remember the Most High's name. We supposed to think on his name. It's clear, man. Of course, the scriptures are very clear how they overlay themselves. Let's get the book of Micah. Micah 4, verse 5. It reveals that we are to walk in Yahweh's name. Not Jesus, not God, not the Lord, but Yahweh, why Yahweh Shah. This is why you hear me saying it at every video, man.
This is the book of you said the book of
Micah 4 verse 5.
Okay.
And good brother Shannon, do I get Psalms 83, 16 through 18?
Salakia, this may be the right. It says the book of Malachi, chapter 4, verse 5.
No, not Malachi, Micah.
Salakia.
Come.
Okay, it's the book of Micah, chapter 4, verse 5. For all people will walk, everyone in the name of his God, and we will walk in the name of the Most High, our power, Yahweh, our power, forever and ever.
Con. So we supposed to walk in that name, man.
Right?
Did you get that? I'm trying to do it. Psalms 83 and 16 through 18.
Psalms 83, 16 through 18. It reads.
And then, brother,
fill their face.
There's Psalms 72 and 17.
Okay, con.
Go ahead,
Psalms 83, 16. Fill their faces with shame that they may seek thy name, O Lord. Is that supposed to be Yahweh?
Yeah, that's
written
right.
Differently.
Yeah.
17. Let them be confounded and troubled forever. Yea, let them be put to shame and perish. 18. That men may know that thou, whose name alone is Yahweh, art the Most High over all the earth.
See that?
Now they differentiated it inside my Bible here. They actually put it, they actually got it down here as Jehovah. But it wasn't the same.
Yeah. That's the Greeks.
They got it. It's all over the place in here.
Yeah, that's the Greeks.
Sometimes they'll have the name, and sometimes they'll have Lord, and then they'll put it in capital. But when you go back to the concordance, it all references Yahweh, which is they're confusing us on purpose.
Yep.
God, this is the book of Psalms. Chapter 72, verse 17. And his name shall endure forever. His name shall be continued as long as the sun, and men shall be blessed in him. All nations shall call him blessed.
So his name's going to endure forever. What are they talking about? No one knows the Most High's name, man.
It says, blessed be Yahweh, power. The power of Israel, who only doeth wondrous things.
So, you know, when we read the book of 2 Samuel, right, 7 and 26, we're told that we're supposed to magnify the Most High's name, Yahweh, right? But in reality, we haven't been magnifying the Most High's name. We've been magnifying unscriptural names and mere titles that might apply to any generic, non-specific deity. You see what I'm saying? Psalms 106 and 47, it talks about that We are to give thanks to Yahweh's name. But clearly, have we been given thanks to his name? Have we been given thanksgiving to his name? We've been given thanksgiving to name of foreigners, like Jesus, like the Lord, like God. You see what I'm saying? Psalms 29 and 2 says, we are to esteem Yahweh's name. Psalms 9 and 2 says that we are to sing praises to Yahweh's name. It goes on and on and on. Isaiah 56 and 6 says, reveal that we are to love Yahweh's name. So how are we someone that's supposed to say the name? Psalms 45 and 17 tells us that every generation to remember Yahweh's name. Exodus 3 and 14 through 15 says that his memorial name to all generations is Yahweh. Salvation is found in Yahweh's name and that of his son, Yahweh Shah. Let's get Psalms 54 verse 1. Psalms 54 verse 1.
This is Psalms chapter 54 verse 1. It says, save me, O power, by thy name, and judge me by thy strength.
Mm-hmm. See that? By thy name. So we're saved by his name. We're not saved by Jesus, God.
We're too bad. Lock it.
Poor Lord. Wow.
Huh. Men that's hidden, disguised, and corrupted, and substituted the name of the Creator. They call it Jehovah and Jesus. No, these are recent, you know, these are just recent origins, right? Jehovah appeared in Greek. Is they spell it I-E-H-O-U-A. In the Geneva translation, in the first printing of the King James Bible. So, you know, in the substituting printing of the King James Bible, the letter J, when you get this King James 1611, the original ones like I got, there's no J there, it's an I. You understand? It's an I there, not a J. So the J began to be used for the first letter of proper nouns that begin with the letter I. And at the beginning of the sentence, the letter J is only a few hundred years old. So, I mean, what's really startling is that when Jehovah is broken down, we have Jehovah with the J-E replacing our father's shortened phonetic name, Yah. You can't even break that down into Yah. Right? Because when you shorten the Most High's name, it's Yah. But when you break the J down, what you get? You get G. You get the J-E. And then the last part, you had Hovah. And so that's referenced in Strong's Exhaustive Concordance as the word H1943. And it means utter destruction and ruin. That's what Hovah means. Don't believe me? Go and check it out for yourself. Go and look it up in Strong's. It means destruction and ruin. We posted in the room for a YouTube version. I'm not going to do much there. We've been on this over 2 hours or something. So, when we speak the hybrid name, Jehovah, we are in essence saying, Yah, he is ruined. You see what I'm saying? And the name Jesus only has been around for the last few hundred years. The J appeared on the planet less than 500 years ago. So clearly, we've been using some, you know, converted food. You know, something from its original, it's distorted from the original name, man. Our Savior, Yahweh Shah. The name Yahweh Shah, Yah is our salvation, was given to Yosef in a dream, not the name Jesus. The name Jesus was never given in it. And so those people that stubbornly continue to cleave to the recent form of Jesus and will not listen to reason, you gotta ask yourselves, right? What does that mean for all of those believers who never used Jesus prior to the 16th century? What does that mean to those people? So in short, where's our respect for the name of the Almighty and His Son? The very same respect that we demand for our own names. How would you like if someone called you your name being Barack? How would you like someone call you I'm just gonna call you Tiffany. I don't think you would like that too much. You know what I mean? It's just wanna use any name. Just wanna use any name. You see what I'm saying? I mean, that's what they doing, man. Hey. We just gonna call him Jesus. Doesn't even mean anything. But you know, yeah, we're just gonna call him next. So, you know, certain beliefs, you know, and certain people that, you know, believers, they feel that they can call on the Father's and the Son's name by any name they choose. That's what a guy said when we was first starting this camp, and I had to kick him out. He trying to pull something in Revelation. I said, brother, man, the name's very important. So yet they feel that Yahweh should have their name, you know, in the scroll of the Lamb, their correct name. You don't want to be called by something else, right? You know, you want to make sure the Lord knows your name so you can be saved, right? So that's clearly a double standard.
Exactly.
That's clearly a double standard, man. So the name of the Most High and His Son, man, is important. Men are not endowed with the authority to choose whenever they prefer to call upon their Savior's name. They must submit to the truth and build on what does not change. And we read the name won't change, man. We're told in the book of Isaiah 52 and 26 that Yahweh's people will know His name. Book of Revelation 3 verse 8 warns us that we're not to deny His name. Why are we denying the name then? Jeremiah 10 and 25, it tells us that Yahweh will pour out His wrath on those who don't call on His name. Someone get that. Let's read that into the let's bring that out, man. Jeremiah 10 and 25. You don't want to use the name. Okay, Nate. And I'm into something, man. All you people that's under Nate that won't say the Lord's name, this applies to you also. I know you don't care because you really don't believe in it. It's all for show and tell.
This is the book of Jeremiah, chapter 10, verse 25. Pour out thy fury upon the heathen that know thee not, and upon the families that call not on thy name, for they have eaten up Jacob and devoured him and consumed him. And have made his habitation desolate.
So not to call on the Lord's name is an act of rebellion, to ignore this scripture, to ignore these instructions. These are not suggestions, man. This is telling you what to do. This is a commandment. The book of Zechariah, for example, right? 13 verse 9 tells us that those who belong to Yahweh will say, Yahweh is His name of my Elohim. Do you understand? The tradition of our fathers had fell. We're straying away, man. We are told in the book of Revelations 2 and 13 that we are to hold fast to His name. But men have not preserved the truth. It has fallen into the streets. Why did the Pharisees and the priests tell Yahawashah's followers not to utter His name? Because they knew that when Yahawashah's name was being uttered, the Father's name was being uttered as well, because the Father's name is in the Son's name. Shemot 23 and 21. Let's get that. Shemot 23 and 21.
This is the book of Exodus, chapter 23, verse 21. beware of him and obey his voice. Provoke him not, for he will not pardon your transgressions. For my name is in him.
See that? His name is, who is he talking about? Now, and this is what killed me about the Old Testament, only Israelites, right? Now, how are they gonna know, how are they gonna deny Hamashiach the Hawashah when the Lord is telling you right now, my name is in him? Who do they think they're talking about, David? This is talking about Hamashiach the Hawashah, man. For my name is in him. So that's why we have Yahweh, why Yahawashah? Because every time you say the Son's name, you gotta say the Most High's name. So when you call on the Son, you call on the Father and the Son. Because his name is in Yahawashah's name. For my name is in him. Shemot 23:21. Exodus 23:21. Now let's examine some more of these excuses that people use before we go. I know we're almost on 3 hours, but so let's look at some of the excuses they use to reject the true name. Some people say Yahweh has many names. No, Yahweh has one name and many titles, such as healer, such as shepherd, such as redeemer, such as father, such as husband, such as protector, and so on and so forth. Some claim that no matter what name they use, Yahweh will know who we mean. This excuse right here, man, that's nothing but prideful arrogance. And it's going to get you deaf, Negro. It's going to get you deaf. Implying that the Creator, implying that the Creator of the Shemayim will just have to figure out and deal with the terms we choose. It's like one of the most appalling things that I ever heard, man. He'll have to take what we ditch out, like it or not. And then you got others that say the pronunciation of Yahweh's name has actually been lost.
We don't know the pronunciation of the name.
Now, do we really believe that? Even for one moment? That Yahweh is going to command us to fall upon his name and then allow the pronunciation to be lost? Do you really believe that? Of course not. La'ah! See, all we must do is sound off the letters, and surely we can trust in the most used word in the scriptures. Some contend that since there's no vowels in the Hebrew per se, that the proper pronunciation is questionable. The Dead Sea Scrolls have revealed many examples of the original letters from which the words of Yahweh were written. Some proclaim that Yahweh's name is found in the Brit Kadasha. But the fact of the matter is that the reason we don't see Yahweh's name in the Brit Kadasha is because it has been replaced, and it became policy to adopt an alternative name, a popular term, a substitution. The Father's name, right? Let's examine this, man. Let's examine the pronunciation of the Father's name. First century writer called Josephus, right? Josephus tells us that the name consists of four vowels. Commonly, we see the name in the encyclopedia as what? The YHWH. These vowel letters stands for Hebrew letters. Yah-ha-wah. Yah-ha-wah. Again, like the brothers say, when some people pronounce it real fast, they would say, who? Now, the way that a lot of people get thrown off is that the wah, the W, is replaced with the va. And in some situations, the ah, the U, A, U. Some of them say, hey, right? So letter Yod is the same as the letter Y. The He is the same as the letter H, the Ha, Ha, same as the letter H. And the Wa, which the Greek sound replaced with the V, is represented as the W, but is essentially the sound of what? The Wa. Then you have the H at the end, which is the Ha. Now the Assyrians heard the transcribes the proper translation of the Father's name as Yahweh. Having lived with the Israelites who'd actually been taken into captivity by the Assyrians, their translations is and should be credible. So these people, they know the name, man. They know the name. So I mean, we've been going on quite some time here, man. And I could go on and on, but we're almost, you know, up to 3 hours. So, yeah, I think we could bring this to a close. Anyone else got anything else, man? Anybody got anything?
Yeah, I appreciate it, man. Thank Yahweh for you and the fire that he's letting the soul keep it coming, brother.
Hey, praise be to the time, man.
God, Zalakia, just one precept, Isaiah chapter 55, verse 6. Seek ye Yahweh while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near.
Yeah, Kahan. Hey, yo, get that Amos 8 and 11 in conjunction with that, brother. Let's see what Kahan happened if they don't call on him.
Kahan, this is the book of Amos, chapter 8, verse 11. Behold, the days come, saith the Most High Yahweh, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, or a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of Yahweh.
Kahan. So, I mean, there's going to come a time when the Most High is going to stop the priest from teaching. Then people are going to want to hear it. But then it's going to be too late. It's going to be too late, man. It's gonna be too late. Hey, you got a short prayer, or something, man, or something you could say to him in the Ibrit, man, before we leave.
Kahan, you want me to, I can just pray the Lord's prayer.
Kahan.
Kahan, so what? Upon Yerushalem, stand and face Jerusalem. That may be the east. We can say Abanawa Shabashimayam Kodas Haya Shamka Yahawa Malakwa Kabaa Rataza One Kahaya Aisha Baarataza Kawahaya Bashimayam the Dunlanawa Lakum Kao Yawam Wasalaklanawa Kawawak Nawa Kasalak Nawa Kawawak Yanawa Walaa W.I. Nawa Banasayawan Nabal Hawashai Nawa Mayan Rai Kayalaka Hamalak Wak Baha Allah Wahakapa Araf La Aibalam Yam The Water Rabalaka Bahashim Hamashayak Yahawashai The Water Rabalaka Marash Kaya and Yana Award Yawada La Aibayam La Aibalam Yam Amen
Amen
Hallelujah Hallelujah Hallelujah
the lot.
And
yo, I'm
going
to study in the room. Shalom. Amen. You still
there, Kahan? Yeah, Kahan. Yeah, I was saying I'm going to post that Lord's Prayer in the room. People that want to learn it. Let me put that up my computer.
Yeah, I like learn that myself.
Kahan, I said it kind of fast. However, yeah, I can, you know, I could even type it in, send it to you. I could say it.
No, I got it right here. I'm gonna post it in the room. I'm gonna share it with you. Yeah. But you could probably, if you could say that slower, you could probably teach them, you know, to say that.
Kahan.
Yeah. We gotta get you to do a class on that.
Kahan. Don, I know, you know, the various prayers, you know, on a daily basis, pursuant to Psalms, it says, you pray three times a day. I believe it's Psalms 55. Pray more.